Hey, before we lose our whole band, I'm actually, stay standing for me for just a second, if you would. I think a lot of times we sing songs like that, and we'll say things like, well, I'm doing this in my heart. And that's really where it all matters in the first place, is in the heart. But I think sometimes it matters that we do it with our bodies too. That we say, this isn't just metaphorical, this isn't just an analogy that I'm using, but God, I'm here today and I am throwing my hands up in front of you saying that everything I have, all that I have, all I can really sum this down to is a hallelujah for you this morning. Because you are the one that I'm here for in the first place, not myself. You are the reason that we have to live every single day. And so God, I lay it all out there for you. This is an act of surrender to say that I put my hands up in front of you and I say that it is all for you this morning. So would you sing that with me just one more time? Sing through that chorus. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. 'Cause all that I have is a hallelujah. I'm nothing less fit for a king, except for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah. God, we do. We have nothing else fit for you. And so we give you what we have. We give you who we are this morning. Amen. Now you can have a seat, which really you could have sat that whole time, but thank you for standing with me. I really believe sometimes it's important to sit there and to be like, you know, it's about what's in the heart when we're worshiping him, but it's also sometimes saying, but I'm willing to do this with my body as well. Because it will be our bodies that leave this place and that go out into the world around us. Just saying that I love the world and I have a heart for the world does no good if our body doesn't go with us and we don't use what he's given us to go out and to reach the world around us. So thank you for that. It's a perfect segue into what we want to talk about this morning as we continue in this idea of walking humbly together with Jesus. When we say to him, I have nothing that's fit for you. I don't have anything that is worthy of you, God, because you are that great and you are that powerful and I am not. I want you to hold on to that thought as we talk this morning about what it means to be humble. But before we get into that truly and dive into that, I do want to acknowledge that it is a big day today. Last week I mentioned that I didn't have any Kansas City Chiefs gear, and so I was blessed by several people in the congregation saying, hey, I have some that you can wear this morning. So I am able to wear some Chiefs. I see that we're actually matching this morning. I love it. Some of you are wearing some gear that is not quite as nice, but you are still representing your team, and I encourage you for that. I realize the Corks are not wearing any kind of Browns gear, and, well, I don't blame you for that. I probably wouldn't own any of that either, even though I used to claim that I've had partial ownership over the team because my last name is Brown, and we actually lived across the road from the Clevelands growing up, so it was great. We had the Cleveland Browns right there. It was obviously not a street that anybody in town cared about. So it was pretty fitting. You're welcome, Patrick. But as you're deciding today who you're going to cheer for, if you're going to cheer for anybody, because I know that there are many of you who are like, I didn't even know there was a game today. And there are others of you who are like, I only watch the game for the commercials, even though they're not as good as they used to be. But, you know, we still have this nostalgia of the commercials are the reason that we watch the game. For the rest of you who are making a decision, I just want to point out that the Kansas City Chiefs have been to the Super Bowl 3 out of the last 4 years. And they've been to the AFC Championship game 5 straight times, hosting it all 5 of those times. We have this guy named Patrick Mahomes, you might have heard of him, and this other guy named Travis Kelce, and we have this coach named Andy Reid. And what I'm really trying to get at is there any reason to cheer for anybody today other than the Chiefs? Because it is clear that the Chiefs are the best team in the NFL. And now you have the option to cheer for the Eagles, and you have the option to say, I still believe that someday, again, my Colts will be good. If you could ever get a quarterback who wanted to play for more than a year, then maybe someday you might be good again. But how could you, again, it's your choice. Just like last week I mentioned as we were in here, and some of you may have caught this, and for some of you, you understood exactly what I meant. Others of you may have kind of struggled with the statement that I made that we have a choice as to who we're going to cheer or who we're going to follow with our lives. That we don't have to choose to walk with Jesus. He gives us the option to walk with somebody else. Now, we believe in here that he is the only way to the Father because he tells us that. In Isaiah, before Jesus was walking physically on the earth, in Isaiah 45, 5 and 6, God made the claim that I am the Lord, for there is no other God. Amen is absolutely right. See, first off, I love it when people respond while I'm up sharing with people. So at any moment, if you agree, and amen is awesome, or yep, that's right, or that's good preaching, I'll take it. Or if you're sitting there and you really disagree and you want to give me an I can take that too. It's all right. I can handle it. I was a youth pastor for, what was that? Cutter, there is a limit to what I will allow, though, okay? As if I have any control over that. But, okay, I'm going to go talk to this side of the sanctuary for the rest of the morning. That side is obviously having issues with humility this morning, so I'm gonna speak to all of you this morning. It's made pretty clear to us that if we are going to walk with Jesus, that a humble heart is required. That we can't choose to follow him and hang on to the prideful hearts that we walk through so much of our lives with. And it can actually be very tempting to, for those of us who have decided that, yes, we are going to walk with Jesus, we are going to follow him. We are the ones who have figured out that this book is true. We are the ones who have figured out that Jesus is the only way to the Father. And the rest of you people, you really need to get on board and you really need to figure things out because you're just being kind of dumb not figuring it. Like, it can be such a quick switch to fall into the trap of pride, the snare. Actually, so I'm taking a class right now through Mid-America Christian University. It's where I got my undergrad degree, taking just a little certificate course through them. And we just last week were given a worksheet called the Snare of Pride, to where it's all of these questions of which ones of these you identify with. I haven't actually filled out the worksheet yet, so I'm not like pulling everything from there, but I'm going to fill it out tomorrow. And if it seems like a really good worksheet, I'm going to send it to all of you and invite you to participate in it as well. Obviously, you don't have to. But we can quickly get pulled into that snare of pride, even though when we walk with him, a humble heart is what he requires of us. When we first began introducing to you this idea that we are called as disciples to walk humbly together with Jesus, immediately, and I love this, I heard back from several people of, hey, Micah 6:8. That's where this is at. It's Micah 6:8. We know this verse, Micah 6:8. Many of us do, where it says, the Lord has told you what is good. And this is what he requires of you. Not what he suggests, not what he asks, what he requires of you. To do what is right, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. The only way to walk humbly, or the only way to walk with Jesus, is to walk humbly. There is no other option. There is no option of I can have pride over here. No, the only way to walk with Jesus is to walk humbly. Now, before we dive in this morning and really get into the thick of this, I do want to point out there is nothing, and at least that I see, wrong with saying I'm proud of my kids or I'm proud of an accomplishment or something like that. This is a different type of pride that we're talking about. Now, when we begin to say I'm proud of my kids because they are so much better than every other kid out there and all those other kids need to figure out how to be like my kids because my kids are perfect, I don't know any parent that would actually truly believe that in the first place, but we would say things like that. That's where this kind of pride becomes an issue. When my kids are the perfect kid and your kid should try to just be like my kid. But there is nothing wrong with being proud of your kid or being proud of an accomplishment that you've had in your life. There's a lot of things that type of pride is perfectly, but it's not what Jesus is talking about when he says that you need to walk humbly with me. So I want to talk this morning what he is talking about. I want you to just for a moment imagine what your life would look like if you truly took, and maybe you have, and this isn't going to be a stretch for you, but if you haven't, what would your life look like if you truly took the command seriously to walk humbly with Jesus? What about your life would look different if you truly took him at his word when he says, no, if you want to walk with me, then humility is the only way that this is going to work. Pride has no place when you're walking with me. How would your life look different? That's the challenge, I think, that he set for a bunch of people who were in a setting similar to this one when he was walking on the earth with us, somewhere between the year 30 and 33 AD, when Jesus was speaking to a crowd that was made up of, honestly, people just like we'll have here. It was made up of people who were sitting there going, I don't believe this stuff. I'm here because someone drugged me here, or I'm here because I'm a little bit curious, but I don't really believe in this man named Jesus. And there were people in the room who were like, I believe in this man named Jesus. And there, you know, some had taken that step of saying, I've chosen to walk with and to follow him. I've chosen to be his disciple. This guy named Jesus, I'm going to put all of my eggs in his basket. Like, this is exactly where it's at. There were people in the room who were sitting there who were saying, I've got this all figured out. You want to know what it means to walk with God? Look at me, because I've got everything figured out. In fact, here's the 600-some rules that you need to follow so that you can also follow God. And I'm going to be the one that's going to let you know if you're doing a good enough job, because I have it all figured out. This Jesus fella, stop listening to him. Listen to me. And we'll have people like that that will show up in a place like this, that maybe not so blatantly will they say it, but will have the attitude of, I have this all figured out, and I am the ultimate example of what it means to follow God and to be a Christian. Look at me. And now, as Jesus was speaking to a group of people like this, and just for the record, as I'm looking out at you, I'm not sitting there going, okay, I think that you fall in this category and you fall. I'm not doing that to you, I promise. But I'm realistic enough to know that when you get a group of this size, you're going to have some of all of those kinds of people. And you've probably encountered some of all those kinds of people. And Jesus was speaking to a group of those kinds of people, those different categories of people. And as he began in Matthew 23, if you want to open up your Bible and you want to follow along, as he began to speak to these people, he began to say some very straightforward, challenging words to them. Words that, you know, I've been told that I can sometimes step on people's toes, and generally people say that and they say, but it's great, keep doing it. Sometimes they don't, but generally they're inviting me to keep stepping on toes. Jesus flat out smashed some toes as he was talking to these people. But he didn't smash the toes of the people who hadn't chosen to believe in God. He wasn't smashing the toes of the people who didn't follow him. He started smashing the toes of the people who thought that they had it all figured out as to what it means to follow God and what it means to be a God follower. When he began to start calling them out for some of their behaviors, when he looked at the people there and he said, listen to the words that they say, because the words that they say are true, but don't look at their actions, because they don't live this out at all. When they're telling you what you need to do wrong, hey, there's some truth in what they're saying, but don't try and be like them, because they are so far off in how they're supposed to be living. They have ignored the intent behind all of those laws that they're telling you to live by. And we get to this point in Matthew chapter 23, if you found it and you want to follow along, we're starting in verse 8, where Jesus looks at them, and again, he's not really talking to all the people in the room. At this point, he's mostly, like, everyone's hearing him, but he's mostly talking to those people who think that they're the good little God followers in the room. And he says, don't let anyone call you rabbi, for you have only one teacher, and all of you are equal as brothers and sisters. See, these people were like, they wanted the attention. They wanted to be known as the rabbi, as the teacher. They wanted to be known as the one who had all the answers. And he's saying, don't let people assume that you have all the answers, because you don't have all the answers. You are all equal. And don't address anyone here on earth as father, for only God in heaven is your father. This has nothing to do with whether this is your biological father. That's not what he's talking about there. You can call someone your biological father. But he's saying you don't elevate people around you to this other standard as the one that is over you and the one that you are ultimately going to follow and listen to. And don't let anyone call you teacher, for you have only one teacher, the Messiah. And in verse 11, he says these words, "The greatest among you must be a servant, but those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted." In the late 2000s, the aughts, I think is what we call that decade, in the late aughts, Suzanne Collins wrote a book series called The Hunger Games. And I don't know if any of you have read that series. I'm actually almost done with it for the second time because there's a new movie coming out, and I wanted to read the book that went along with the movie, and then that prompted me to want to read the whole series all over again. I will confess, I like young adult novels. It makes me feel like I'm still young. I don't like all of them, but I like some of them, and so I'm rereading them. But in the Hunger Games series, and there's going to be some spoilers here, so if you don't want to hear it, plug your ears. I feel like I've given you 10-plus years to read them, so if I spoil something at this point, I feel like that's more on you. But in the Hunger Games series, there's this place called the Capital, and then there are these 12 other areas called the Districts. And the Capital are the people who have life all together. They've got all the nice things in life. They've got the air conditioning and the heat, and they've got the unlimited food. They're the ones who, when they go to a feast, they actually take pills to make themselves throw up halfway through it so that they can enjoy more of the food and they can keep on going so they can empty their stomachs and have more room. Well, the District people, well, they're just the ones who, they just mess up in everything in life, and they're in the place that they're in because of poor choices that they've made, and they don't have all of these nice things. In fact, they only have what they have because of the graciousness of the people in the Capital, because the people in the Capital are so good and they treat them so well. Never mind that the whole premise of the series is about how they take two children from these districts every year and they make them go in an arena and start killing each other to remind the District people just how pathetic they really are and just how great the Capital is. See, in this world that Suzanne Collins wrote, and I don't think she was writing it from a Christian perspective, but she caught some Christian perspectives in it. In this world that she wrote, there were people who had it, and there were people who didn't have it. There were people who were exalted, and there were people who were humbled in this world. And as you read through the story, spoiler alert, the Districts rebel, and the Districts find themselves being exalted, while the Capital finds itself being humbled. I won't give you all the process as to how they got there, but it really is a fascinating story. But here's where Suzanne Collins veers off from the teaching that Jesus gives us. See, she caught the part that those who are exalted will be humbled and those who are humbled will be exalted, but she forgot the part that Jesus isn't talking about here on earth. Jesus is talking about a kingdom that is not of this world. Where he says that in this kingdom that is not of this world, those of you who are exalted here, you're going to be humbled in the kingdom. And those of you who are humbled here in this world will be exalted in the kingdom. Many times we try and flip that, and we are looking to find the exaltation here while we are here on this earth, while we are living, while we are breathing, while these bodies are doing what these bodies do before they die and they begin to decompose. We are sitting there and we're looking for the exaltation there. We want the attention here. We want to be known as good here. And we're not looking to what Jesus talks about, which Jesus is talking about the kingdom that is both here and not yet. And he says, in that kingdom, that is the kingdom where your exaltation will come. Suzanne Collins wrote it in there to where the exaltation came here, and when the Districts had their uprising and the Districts took down the Capital, well, the Districts decided it was time to send the Capital people into the arena. And it was time to have their children start killing one another to show that the Districts We're the better people, which is how we often view life. That we walk through and we say that for those who are oppressed, for those who are beaten down, that the way that this is supposed to work is that we flip the script. But Jesus is saying it's not about what's happening here on this earth. It's about what's happening in the kingdom that is so much greater. In my kingdom, there is no place for pride. There's no place for it. There's only room for humility. The Apostle Paul gives us in several examples as we look through his letters that he wrote to different churches as to how it is that we live out this life of humility. Because again, we can quickly start looking at it as something that it's not. We can quickly start looking at humility as this is just about me being worthless, and we're going to talk about that here in a little bit. But it's important for us to start to look and to see what it is, and we're actually going to look at some things that Paul tells us not to do in order to live humble lives. In Romans chapter 12 and verse 3, Paul writes to the church in Rome and he says, this is how we make sure that there is no place for pride in our life. Don't think that you are better than you really are. Be honest in your evaluation of yourselves, measuring yourselves by the faith that God has given you. It can be really easy in our lives to begin to think that we are better than we really are. In fact, we're taught, again, to do this. We live in an area that is mostly, not completely, but mostly South Knox people. South Knox schools, you know, kind of this area down here. We're in Knox County. There's other schools a part of this, but it can be really easy to forget that there are other schools that are a part of Knox County. Can it not? In fact, I wanted to give Courtney a hard time for this, and then I kept forgetting to do so, but you might have caught that on the slide, it said that you could wear your Chiefs or your Eagles or your other teams or even your South Knox gear, because Courtney's from South Knox. Martha's wearing Reveille this morning. We've got Vincennes Lincoln represented here. And hey, now we're getting some response. Man, I'm noticing that your responses are a lot more likely to come when you're tearing somebody down. I'm not sure how I feel about this. Maybe I need to keep speaking. How about we do that? School pride's a good thing. I think we should. I think we should cheer on our teams. I think that we should look at the good things about our schools. But we can be taught, and we can fall into the trap of walking around as if we are the best and nobody else has it figured out like we have it figured out. I've seen that here in South Knox. I've seen it when I lived in Casper. I've seen it when I lived in Tulsa. I've seen it in the town that I grew up, although the town I grew up didn't have another school in town. We were a one-school town. The county was a one-school county. But we definitely thought we were better than the towns around us. You better believe it. None of them had it figured out. I moved on from there and I realized, oh man, we didn't have it figured out either, like at all. See, we're taught that the attitude that we're supposed to have is that we have everything figured out, and those around us don't. In fact, they're not even close to having it figured out. But Paul tells us to remember your true place, not the place that the world gives you. C.S. Lewis said it this way. He said that there is no fault of which we are more unconscious in ourselves and probably conscious of it in others. Pride, by its very nature, is deceitful. See, it's real easy to recognize that somebody else is very prideful, but not me. I'm better than that. I actually remember a time, so I was in a quartet when I was in college, and my brother-in-law was in the same quartet. He wasn't my brother-in-law at that point, but that's a long story anyway. My now brother-in-law was in the quartet with me, and I remember him standing up in front of a congregation during one of our concerts, kind of introducing who we all were. This isn't the time that he forgot my name. This is another time. But introducing who we were, and I remember him sitting there and saying, you know, I'm kind of proud of how humble I am. He didn't catch it. Like, the other three of us were sitting there like, what did he just say? And I mean, we've given him a hard time about it for like the last 15 plus years about, hey, remember how proud you are of how humble you are? We're so proud of you for your humility. I mean, we're never going to let that one go.
Yes,
I don't doubt it. I don't doubt it. Humility is recognizing that you may not be the perfect saint that you think you are, that you may not have it all figured out quite as much as you think you do. Paul says, be honest in your evaluation, measuring yourselves by the faith that God has given you. He also says in Romans chapter 12, just a few verses later, which again, he wasn't writing this in verses. This was just a letter that he wrote. But he says, don't be too proud to enjoy the company of ordinary people. In verse 16, for those of you who are looking for it in there. Don't be too proud to enjoy the company of ordinary people, which is another trap that we can quickly find ourselves in, that I want to surround myself with the people who other people think are really good people. Because then they'll look at me and think that I'm a really important, good person too. Any of you know who Sam Rayburn was? I mean, it was a long time ago, so I thought maybe there'd be some history buffs in here who might know who Sam Rayburn was. Sam Rayburn was the 43rd, I believe, 43rd Speaker of the House of Representatives in the United States of America. Sam Rayburn was a very powerful person in the United States. The Speaker of the House is third in line to become President of the United States. If the President dies, the VP dies, Speaker of the House, next one in. So Sam Rayburn had a pretty important job. Sam Rayburn had a whole lot of prestige. Sam Rayburn had a direct line to the President of the United States. Having coffee with him, having lunch with him, like conversation all the time. People cared about what Sam Rayburn had to say. And one day, Sam Rayburn had an invitation for just one of those meals with the President of the United States, but he found out that one of his reporter friends, who wasn't really all that popular, who wasn't really all that well known, he wasn't the, you know, the big CNN guys or the Fox News guys that everyone knows their name. He was just a reporter. But Sam Rayburn heard that this reporter had lost his child. And so the next thing the reporter knew was Sam Rayburn, the third most powerful person in the United States of America, was knocking on his door. And as he opened up the door, Sam looks at him and he says, well, I don't know his exact words, I wasn't there, but Sam asks him what it is that he can do for him. And his response that he hears from the reporter is essentially, we've got everything put together. We're making arrangements for the funeral. Now, Sam could have quickly just said, okay, I just wanted to check in. I've got lunch with the president. But instead, Sam looked at him and says, but have you had any coffee yet this morning? No, we haven't had our coffee. Well, then let me make you a cup of coffee. And as Sam walked in, as the story goes, as Sam walked into this reporter's house, the reporter looks at him and says, wait a second. Don't you have lunch with the president of the United States today? And as the story goes, Sam's response to him was, yes, but I told the president, I have a friend today who's in need, and that I need to be with that friend today. Sam Rayburn looked at the man who is typically referred to as the most powerful person in the world, and at that point was referred to him that way even more, and said, hey, I know this is where everyone else would say that I need to be because you're that powerful, but I need to be over here with this ordinary person that nobody cares about. Don't be too proud to spend your time with ordinary people, whether it be the old nemesis that you have from high school, for those of you who live where you went to high school, or whether it just be that person in town that's the outcast. Students, don't be too proud to be with ordinary people, even the other students who everybody else looks at and they think they're weird or they think they smell funny. Jesus says, don't be too proud, because there is no place for pride walking with me. Paul wrote to the church in Philippi in chapter 2, verses 3 and 4. He says, don't be selfish. Don't try to impress others. Be humble. Thinking of yourselves as better than yourselves, or thinking of others as better than yourselves. Don't look out only for your own interests, but take an interest in others too. This walk in humility is recognizing that we are not the only people that walk on this earth. We are not the only people who have a need that are walking around us. Now, it's not saying that your need doesn't matter. It's not saying that you're careless about your life and nothing about your life matters, but he's saying don't forget that there are people surrounding you who also have needs, who also have hurts, who also have struggles. Don't look at yourself as being so much more important than them that you don't need to care about their feelings and their thoughts and their needs. Don't look at yourself as better than you really are. Don't look out for only your own interests. Instead, he writes to the church in Colossae in chapter 3 and verse 12. He says, since God chose you to be the holy people he loves, you must clothe yourselves with tenderhearted mercy, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. In the church, to the church in Ephesus in chapter 4, verses 1 and 2, he says, therefore I, a prisoner serving for the Lord, beg you to lead a life worthy of your calling, for you have been called by God. And people would hear that and be like, okay, a life worthy of my calling. That means I need to be better than everybody else around me. I need to be that good. But what he says is always be humble and gentle. Be patient with each other, making allowance for each other's faults because of your love. If we want to define what humility is, I think it's important for us to look at the words around the words. That the humble person, the person who is walking humbly together with Jesus, that person is a compassionate person, caring for the needs of those around them. That person is a kind person. They are generous instead of being all about themselves and self-serving. They are considerate of others. They are gentle. They are patient. They seek justice. They love mercy. They're all of these things. And those things don't point back to just themselves and making their life better. But it's always looking out at those around us. Walking humbly, while not what's glorified in our world, as we have debates about who is the goat in this and who's the goat greatest of all time, for those of you who think we're talking farming here. Who's the goat in football? Who's the goat in baseball? Who's the goat in science? Who's the goat here? Who's the goat there? And we need to figure all this out. Jesus instead says, no. When you walk with me, it's a beautiful thing because we walk humbly. Humility is not the antithesis of confidence. It's not saying I'm worthless, I have no confidence. Instead, it is confidence in Jesus. It is not weakness. It's a declaration of our love for God. Humility is not worthlessness. It's not considering myself as having no worth whatsoever, but instead it's knowing that your worth comes from Jesus. Humility is recognizing that the gap between you and God, between your greatness and his greatness, is so much wider than any perceived gap that you may have between yourself and somebody else who's walking on this earth with you. You have much more in common with the person sitting down the pew from you or the person who lives three blocks away from you when it comes to your greatness than you do with God. And yet he decided to come down and to be one of us. See, that person that has this great chasm between us and him, he gave up the seat of honor to instead kneel as a servant in front of us. He gave up the most exalted position to instead take that of a humble servant, to instead give up his life for us. See, when we live in pride, we set up ourselves as the measuring stick. In fact, we kind of start to be a little bit proud of how humble we are. But when we walk in humility, we set Jesus as the measuring stick. And he is the ultimate example of what it means to walk humbly. It can be really easy to be like those men and women that Jesus was talking to, mostly men at that time in that culture. It can be really easy to become like them and be like, I've got this all figured out. And I can't believe that the rest of the world around me hasn't gotten on board yet. I can't believe that they don't see what it is that I see. that they're not living the way that I live, that they're not making the choices that I make. Instead of measuring ourselves against Jesus. And when we say we choose to walk humbly together with him, to put him as the ultimate example of what it means to follow God. Often as we choose to make that step, it's going to be one little step at a time towards a big God. Now, we can tend to look at it as more of a, you know, it's the American way. It's one giant leap, right? One giant step. When he's saying, you've just made a little one. Now take another little one. I'm going to put the lamp before your feet. I want you to look at me as your example. And let's walk you towards this big God. What would your life look like if you chose to take Jesus seriously when he told us to walk humbly with him, to live in humility? Because if you choose to walk humbly with him, he will not suggest, if you choose to walk with him, he will not suggest, but he will command that you walk humbly. That there will be no place for pride when you choose to walk with him. It's a beautiful thing when we do it. We see others, and when they live a humble life, we celebrate the humility that others live with as we seek to have our lives be better and more glorified. But what would happen if we chose as a church, if we chose as individuals to say we're not going to be about exalting ourselves. We're going to be about exalting him. And we are going to choose this day to walk humbly together with him. What would that look like? We're going to sing a song to close out this morning. And I think it's, is it a brand new one or have we done it once? Okay, I thought it was brand new. But in the song, you're going to hear the words that Jesus is our firm foundation. Jesus is the rock upon which we stand. And now I know that we're talking about walking and the song is talking about standing on a solid rock and all that kind of stuff. They're different metaphors, and I understand that. But the meaning behind them is still the same. Who will you choose to walk with? Who will you choose to have be your foundation? What would it look like if we completely surrendered? Completely, not holding a little bit back, but completely surrendered and said, God, I want to walk humbly with you. I would invite you to ask that question as we sing this song. Would you stand with us? Man, can we hear it for a God who will never fail us? I mean, I need to remind you that I cheer for the team that has the loudest outdoor stadium in the world, according to the Guinness Book of World Records. And I've heard them cheer, and I would love to hear that kind of energy when it comes to giving it up for God. So can we do that this morning as we get ready for something later? Like, let's hear that.
Touchdown, God! Woo!
Not the Eagles, the Chiefs, just so you're remembering later who you're cheering for. Hey, next week, we do this, and we walk this way, and we believe that he won't fail, but we also know that sometimes we need others. Actually, all the time, we need others. And we need others to remind us. We need others to walk with us. We need others to build us up. We need others to pray for us. We need others. And that's why we have in this statement we've been talking about that we walk humbly together with Jesus. We're going to start talking about what that means to be together next week. As we get ready to take off this morning, though, and as you get ready to cheer for the Chiefs later on today, remembering that God comes first, Chiefs are after him. But thank you very much. I was sitting here and I was speaking this morning and I was looking out here and I was like, man, that person that I'm seeing here looks really familiar, but I can't place who this is. And then all of a sudden it hit me like, hey, this is Mark Nielsen. And so, Mark, can I have you come up and pray us out this morning? Cutter's over here like, what? Sorry, he just found you. You can't get out of here quietly now. I'm not giving you this mic, though. That'd be weird.
Let's take a moment and pray. Gracious God, we thank you for the day. Thank you for an opportunity to worship and hear your word this morning. Thank you that we follow the one who lived out humility in an amazing way, that he gave up his home in heaven, gave up all the rights of deity to come and live among us, to humble himself, to empty himself, to become obedient, a servant, even to the point of death, that he would die on the cross for our sins. We give you thanks and praise for all of this. We thank you for this church. Thank you for Pastor Justin and for his team. Thank you for the opportunity to worship today. Lord, help us to go forth with humility and serve you and live for you in every way that we know how. In the powerful and mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Have a great week.